Today's topic is disease condition related to the digestive system. Okay, in that, what is disease condition? Means any structural deviation or functional deviation in any organ which we have learned into the digestive system. So that we will see in today's lecture. First, we will see the disorder of the mouth. Okay. So in oral cavity or buccal cavity, is there any deviation or structural or functional malformation or any problem or deviation that will cause the disease? So first one, the first condition, that is inflammatory and infectious condition. Okay, there will be an inflammation and infection in particular organ, okay, in oral cavity. So first one is a oral thrush. Oral thrush is known as oral candidiasis. Okay, why candidiasis? Because causative organism of the oral candidiasis, that is known as a Candida albicans. So that's why the oral thrush is known as oral candidiasis. Okay, so it is a fungal infection. Okay, it is a fungal infection. Okay, it is caused by a yeast. Yeast is a fungal infection. So fungal infection, it is caused by the Candida albicans, that is known as a oral thrush. Now we will see which are the symptom or characteristic feature of the oral candidiasis. In that, first you can see in the figure. Okay, see, this is the creamy white patches. You can see this is the creamy white patches over the tongue and the mucosa, okay, oral mucosa. So white patches, that is in creamy form, as well as slightly raised lesion, okay, embossed lesion, that is looks like a cottage cheese, okay, cheese like appearance they gives. Okay, so white patches, that is creamy in form, as well as they looks like a cottage cheese. So redness and burning or soreness, that may be severe enough to cause difficulty in eating or swallowing. Okay, so there will be redness, burning sensation over the mucosa and the tongue, and soreness, and because of these symptoms, person cannot eat or swallow the food. Then slightly bleeding if the lesions are rubbed or the scrap. Okay, if we are scrubbing or if we are giving force to the lesion, they will be slightly bleeding. So these are the symptoms related to the oral thrush. Now second condition, there is the angular halitis. Okay, means what? Angular halitis. Okay, means what? It is also known as the synonym of the angular halitis, that is the angular stomatitis and pearlash. Means what? Okay, stomatitis means inflammation or infection of the mucous membrane of oral cavity, and angular stomatitis means what? The inflammation will radiate at the angular side of the lips. Okay, at the two angle. So it may be infection or inflammation bile present at one side or both side of the lips. Then the causative organism for the halitis, that is the Candida albicans and Staphylococcus aureus. So these are the fungal and the bacterial infections. Then symptom. Which are the symptom? Then swollen red patches at the corner of the lips. You can see this is the swollen and red patches at the angle or corner of the lips. Then the corners are red with a skin breakdown and crusting. Okay, you can see the corner becomes are red and they are breakdown. Then sometime it may be itchy and painful. Okay, people or person, or we can say patient, feels like scrambling over the lesion area. Then progress. We will see the progress of this disorder, that is it may take a few days or it may be a chronic problem to the years. Okay, if proper medication is not given to the patient. So this is all about the angular halitis. Then third disease condition, that is gingivitis. Okay, what is gingivitis? Gingiva and itis. Okay, gingiva and itis. Okay, what is gingiva? That is the gums. Okay, what is the meaning of gingiva? That is the gums. And itis means infection or inflammation of the organs. So what is gingivitis? Means inflammation or infection of the gums. So it might be acute or chronic. So what is the meaning of acute and chronic? Acute in that illness occur gradually or suddenly, and it takes, or for the relieving of the symptom, it takes a short time, okay, like a days, like a week, while in chronic, the illness occur gradually and slowly and the prognosis will be poor. It may take years or month. So it might be acute or chronic. The causative organism of the gingivitis, that is accumulation of bacterial plague around the teeth. Okay, if there is any food plague are deposited or accumulation of the food deposition are there, so bacterial fermentation are there and they will cause the infection or inflammation to the gums. So which are the symptom and characteristic of the gingivitis? First one is a swollen and shiny gums. You can see this is the swollen and shiny gums. Then bright red or purple gums. Then painless. Mostly, okay, commonly it is painless, except the pressure is applied. If we are doing force or pressure over the gums, then it will be painful. Otherwise, it is a painless. Then bleeding gums. If we are doing a pressure or if we are doing brush, okay, at that time blood will come from the gums. So there will be bleeding gums and bad breath, that is known as a halitosis. Okay, what is the meaning of halitosis? It is a medical terminology, that is a bad breath, foul smell or bad odor. Okay, that is a halitosis because of the accumulation of the bacterial plague into the gums. So this is the gingivitis. Then fourth condition, that is recurrent aphthous stomatitis. Okay, what is stomatitis? Infection or inflammation of the mucous membrane of oral cavity. And what is aphthous? There is a small and superficial ulcer over the skin or mucous membrane. And what is recurrent? Means it occurs frequently. Okay, so it is very common and recurrent. Okay, it occurs frequently. Then extremely painful ulceration that occur single or in a crops in any part of the oral cavity. You can see this is a ulcer. Okay, this is a patchy ulcer. Okay, it might be single or in a group. Okay, they are very small and superficial ulcer are there, so that's why it is very painful. So this, the etiopathogenesis is yet unknown. Okay, yet the etiology or causative organism is unclear. Okay, we cannot know about the causative organism. Then next one is a tumors of the mouth. Okay, in that squamous cell carcinoma. Okay, this is the most common type of the malignant tumor. Okay, what is squamous cell carcinoma? That is a common type of the skin cancer. Okay, that may be found over the skin in any part of the body. So that is a squamous cell carcinoma. Okay, so it is a one type of skin cancer. Okay, it is a common type of malignant tumor. Malignant means cancerous tumor. Tumor means abnormal growth of tissue as well as the cells, and they create one mass or lump that is known as a tumor. It might be cancerous or it might be non-cancerous. Cancerous tumor is called as a malignant tumor and non-cancerous tumor is called as a benign tumor. So symptom of the squamous cell carcinoma in the oral cavity, it generally occurs into older adult, okay, mostly in the 50 years of age. Then usually tumors develop on the floor of the mouth. You can see on the floor of the mouth, at the edges of the tongue, okay, at the edges of the tongue, then ulceration, there will be ulcers over the mucosal membrane, then minimal pain during the early stage. Okay, while developing the tumor, there will be minimal pain. Then prognosis is very poor because it is a malignant tumor. Okay, so this is the squamous cell carcinoma. Then congenital disorder. So what is the meaning of congenital? Congenital means the problems that will be occurs or deficiency or any deviation occur into the organ at the fetal growth as well as after the birth. Okay, that is a congenital abnormality. Okay, any abnormality found into the fetal development as well as after the birth. So there is a congenital disorder. In that, first one is a cleft palate and cleft lip. Okay, cleft lip is known as a hell lip. Okay, so during the embryonic development, the roof of the mouth in that hard palate, that develop as a two separate half. Okay, at the time of the birth as well as during the embryonic development into the womb, into the uterus, during the fetal development, there will be one separation or one cleft into the hard palate, into the upper surface. See, this is in upper surface, in hard palate there is a cleft. Okay, so that is a cleft palate. Then this occur from the lips anteriorly to the uvula posteriorly. From anterior side there is a lip, the cut or cleft into the lip in that anterior surface. At the posterior line there is a uvula. Okay, so this line from anterior to lips to the uvula, the hard palate or soft palate, that is a separated portion. So which are the contributing factor or causative factor? So certain drugs and poor nutrition between 7 to 12 week of pregnancy, during the antenatal period, if mother is taking drugs or if she is not taking proper nutrition during the 7 to 12 month of the pregnancy, this is the causative agent or we can say causative situation for the development of the cleft lip and cleft palate. In that, during the with the condition of the cleft lip and palate, there will be a drinking, eating and development of speech do not take place. Why? Because during the speech or drinking or eating of food, there will be need of the palate and lip. So in that, in patient with the cleft lip and cleft palate, there is a no hard palate as well as no lips. So these problems are occur because of the this condition. So until the surgery will done, okay, until the surgery will done, the this type of activity we cannot do. So surgical repair will be done. So there will be surgical intervention for this type of the congenital disorder like cleft lip and cleft palate. The next one, there is a dental caries. Okay, dental caries, in that, what is dental caries? So it is also known as a tooth decay that will start with the discoloration of the tooth and formation of cavity or caries into the teeth. There will be hole into the teeth. There will be cavities or hole into the teeth and discoloration of the teeth. Then this is will definitely cause the dental caries. So localized destruction of the tissue of the teeth occur in the dental caries. So which are the cause? Bacterial fermentation of dietary carbohydrate. If carbohydrate or food deposition are there into the teeth, then what happens? The fermentation of food or carbon dioxide will be there. So that cause the dental caries. Then sugar. If we are taking more sugary food, there will be deposition of the sugary content into the teeth and they will cause the cavities. Then acid. Okay, acid is also one of the cause for the tooth decay and destruction of the tissue of the teeth. Caries can be prevented by the good oral hygiene. Okay, if we are doing proper or good brushing to the teeth and we are removing the food particles from the oral cavity or from the teeth, then there will be minimal or less chances for the tooth decay and the dental caries. Now we will see the disease condition which is related to pharynx. Okay, in that first one is a tonsillitis. Okay, what is tonsillitis? Tonsil plus itis. Okay, means what? Infection or inflammation of the tonsils. So what is tonsillitis? Infection or inflammation of the tonsils, that is tonsillitis. Most common cause, that is the Staphylococcus pyogenes. Okay, Staphylococcus pyogenes is the causative organism for the tonsillitis. You can see in the figure what is tonsillitis. See, this is a tonsil. They are inflamed. Means inflammation of tonsil, that is tonsillitis. Now we will see the symptom. In that, you can see this is the red and swollen tonsil, white or yellow patches or coating over the tonsil. See, this is the white deposition or yellow patches. Then sore throat, or we can say ulcer into the throat area. Then difficult or painful swallowing. Even we cannot drink a water, or we cannot swallow a single sip of water because of the inflammation of the tonsil. Then because of the infection, there will be increased temperature into the body, that is fever. Then enlarged and tender glands, that is lymph node. In the neck, you can see or you can palpate the lymph node behind the ear. Okay, here there is a lymph node, so lymph node will become enlarged. So this is a tonsillitis, means inflammation or infection of the tonsil. Now we will see the disease condition which is related to salivary gland. Okay, first one, that is the mumps. Okay, what is mumps? That is an acute inflammatory condition of the salivary gland, especially parotid gland. There will be inflammation of the parotid gland, that is known as a mumps. Which is the causative organism for the mumps? That is mumps virus. Okay, mumps virus is causative organism for the mumps disease. It is a one type of the para influenza group. Most commonly it occurs into the 5 to 15 years of the age. Okay, during the 5 to 15 years of age, mumps is generally developed. You can see in the figure, this is the patient of the mumps. Okay, see, this is the inflammation of the parotid gland. Symptom, in that pain in the swollen salivary glands on one or both side of your face. Okay, here there is a parotid gland. So inflammation of parotid gland, because there is a salivary gland and this side there will be a pain or swollen area. You can see this is the swollen area. So pain while chewing or swallowing, because at the side of the neck there is inflammation. So during the swallowing or chewing, pain will be occur. Then fever because of the infection into our body. Then headache because of the swelling over the neck as well as the face area. Then muscle ache because of the swollen and infection area at the neck or at the face area. Then weakness and fatigue. This is a general symptom for the disease condition. So what is mumps? There is infection or inflammation or swollen area at the parotid gland. Then tumors of the salivary gland. What is tumor? Okay, it is abnormal growth of the tissue, or they are collected into a mass, that is a tumor. So in tumor are also present into the salivary gland. Okay, so in that first one is a salivary adenoma. Okay, so adenoma, it is also represent as a tumor. Okay, it is most common tumor. Okay, benign tumor occur mainly in parotid gland. Okay, in parotid gland you can see this is a benign tumor. Okay, so which are the symptoms a lump or swelling on or near jaw area as well as the neck into the and to the mouth. Okay, in neck, in mouth, and at the jaw area there is swelling, numbness over the face, then muscle weakness on one or both side of the face, then persistent pain, okay, continuous pain, that is long lasting pain. Persistent means continuous and long lasting pain into the area of the salivary gland or parotid gland, then difficulty in swallowing and wide opening of the mouth. Okay, we can note or patient cannot open widely here his or her mouth because of the swelling over the neck or jaw area. So this is a salivary adenoma. Then second, that is a carcinoma. Okay, what is carcinoma? These bodies related to the cancer. Okay, cancer. So malignant tumor most commonly affect the parotid gland. Generally in parotid gland the malignant tumor are developed. So malignant tumor, cancerous tumor can be occur at the parotid gland. See, this is the carcinoma of the parotid gland. Now we have completed the disorder of the oral cavity and the pharynx. Now we will see the disorder or disease condition related to the esophagus. After oral cavity there is esophagus. Now we will see the disease condition which is related to the esophagus. In that, first one is a esophageal varices. Okay, what is esophageal varices? So there is enlarged vein into the tube. Into the esophagus you can see this is the enlarged vein. Okay, see, this is the enlarged vein into the esophagus, into the tube. So this condition is occur most often in people with the liver disease. So mostly, generally, the cause is liver disease. In patient with the liver disease, they cause the esophageal varices. Why? Because in the liver there will be a disease condition or there will be obstruction of the blood flow. So blood where will go near or surrounding area to the esophagus. Okay, so they will cause esophageal varices. Okay, vein become a prominent. Okay, prominent. So symptom of the esophageal varices. So first one is vomiting large content or large amount of the blood because of the venous drainage or venous prominency. Then black, tarry and bloody stool. Then loss of consciousness in the severe cases. So these are the general symptoms of the esophageal varices. So what is esophageal varices? Enlarged vein into the esophagus. Now inflammatory and infectious disease. In that, first one is a esophagitis. Okay, you can see esophagus and itis. Means what? Esophagitis means inflammation of the esophagus. Okay, so inflammation in the lining of the esophagus, that is known as a esophagitis. So mostly occur because of the reflux of stomach acid. Reflux of stomach acid which irritate inside lining of the esophagus. Okay, regurgitation of the gastric acid through the esophageal sphincter, the regurgitation or gastric fluid, they will back into the esophagus and they will create or irritation to the mucosal lining of the esophagus and they cause the esophagitis. So which are the symptoms of the esophagitis? So first one is a difficult and painful swallowing because of the swollen area into the esophagus. Chest pain, particularly behind the breastbone, and that occur with the eating. During the eating there will be a chest pain. Then swollen food becoming stuck in the esophagus, or we can say food impaction. Okay, food will be stuck into the esophagus because of esophagus wall will be thicker. Okay, or swollen. Heartburn because of the chest pain or chest burn. Then acid regurgitation, acid will backflow into the esophagus and they will cause the acid regurgitation. So these are the esophagitis. Means what? Infection or inflammation of esophagus. Now, second condition in that inflammatory and infectious disease condition of esophagus in that gastroesophageal reflux disease means GORD. Okay, GORD represent gastroesophageal reflux disease. As its name suggests, there will be a backflow or regurgitation of the gastric content proximally into the esophagus. Okay. Typically, why? Because due to the transient relaxation of the lower esophageal sphincter. See, this is the lower esophageal sphincter, Okay, so there will be a relaxation of the lower esophageal sphincter and the backflow of the gastric content into the esophagus. So this condition is known as a gastroesophageal reflux disease. Which are the symptoms? Burning sensation in your chest. Why? Because the gastric content or gastric acid will backflow into the esophagus. That's why they create a chest pain, usually after the eating, and which might be worsened at the night. Chest pain, then difficulty in swallowing because of the sphincter, or we can say lower esophageal sphincter become relaxed. So that's why difficulty in swallowing, regurgitation of food or sour liquid because of gastric content, the sensation of the lump in the throat. We feel like there will be food is stuck into the throat. So there will be a sensation of lump in the throat area. So this is the gastroesophageal reflux disease. Now third condition, that is the Barrett's esophagus. Okay. What is Barrett's esophagus? An abnormal or metaplastic change in the mucosal cells lining of the lower portion of the esophagus. At the lower portion of the esophagus, there will be abnormal cell change. Okay, cell changes are done because of gastric acid will backflow into the esophagus, and they will cause the irritation to the lower portion of the esophagus. So these are the causative agent or causative action. So columnar cells resembling those found into the stomach, okay, they replace the squamous epithelium. Okay, here squamous epithelium are there, they replaced by a columnar cells. Okay, so the thick lining of the esophagus are there in the particular lower portion of the esophagus. So this is known as a Barrett's esophagus. Then next condition, that is the achalasia. Means what? Lower esophageal sphincter fail to open up during the swallowing. During the ingestion of the food, the lower esophageal sphincter is failed to open up. So food cannot go inside to the stomach. So which are the symptoms? So inability to swallow means what? Dysphagia. Okay, this is a medical terminology. Okay, dysphagia means what? Inability to swallowing the food or liquid. So which may feel like food or drink that may be stuck into the throat. Then regurgitation of food or saliva. Then heartburn, or we can say chest pain at the that comes and goes. Then coughing at the night. Then pneumonia because of the aspiration of food into the trachea. And weight loss because of the low amount of the food ingestion into daily life. So there will be gradual weight loss. So these are the symptoms of the achalasia. What is achalasia? There is lower esophageal sphincter are failed to open up during the swallowing. Now we will see the tumor of the esophagus. In that, first one is a malignant tumor of the esophagus. So it is oftenly found into the male and female in both sexes. Then most common in the lower esophagus. Generally into the lower esophagus the tumor are found or seen. They might be always or might be benign or malignant. What is malignant? That is related to the cancer. Okay, so there is a cancerous tumor cell that is found into the lower part of the esophagus. You can see this is the tumor. Okay, see, this is the tumor, that is a malignant tumor that found into the lower portion of the esophagus. Now the congenital disorder of the esophagus. Okay. In that first one is a esophageal atresia. Okay. What is esophageal atresia? It is a rare birth defect. Okay. Lumen is narrow or blocked. You can see in the figure. See, this lumen is narrow or it is a blocked. The upper part of the esophagus does not connect with the lower part of the esophagus and stomach. Okay, see, this is a hanging esophagus. The upper part is esophagus upper part that doesn't connect to the lower part of the, see, this is the lower part, see, this is the upper part. So upper part of the esophagus does not connect to the lower part of the esophagus. Okay, there will be cut or we can say blocked pathway of the esophagus. So this condition is known as esophageal atresia. So which are the symptoms? Frothy white bubbles in the baby's mouth, then coughing or choking when feeding, blue color of the skin, especially when baby is feeding. While feeding, baby's skin will be blue in color because this condition is known as bluish discoloration of skin, that is known as the cyanosis. So because lack of oxygen supply to the body or tissue, that is cyanosis. So difficulty in breathing. So these are the basic symptoms of the esophageal atresia. Now second congenital disorder of the esophagus, that is a tracheoesophageal fistula, that is known as a TEF, TEF. Okay, tracheoesophageal fistula. So opening of the opening or fistula between the esophagus and trachea, okay, that is known as a tracheoesophageal fistula. You can see in the figure, see, this is a fistula or we can say opening between the trachea and the esophagus. Okay, so they are connected in between. So swallowed liquids or food can be aspirated or inhaled into child's lung because of the there is connection between the trachea and the esophagus. So this is the tracheoesophageal fistula. This is a rare birth defect or congenital abnormality or disorder into the child. Now we will see the disorder of the stomach. Okay, after the esophagus there is a stomach. Now we will see which are the disorder of the stomach. First one is a gastritis. Okay, gastritis means what? There is inflammation of the stomach. Okay, itis, that represent as a inflammation. So inflammation of the stomach, that is known as a gastritis. So it might be acute or chronic. Okay, the caused by the corrosive effect of the gastric juice, irritant drugs and alcohol. So these are the positive agents. They can create irritation to the gastric mucosa. Okay, and they create the inflammation or infection to the gastric mucosa. Okay, gastric juice, corrosive effect of gastric juice, drugs and alcohol. Which are the symptoms for the gastritis? Okay, first one is a stomach upset or pain into the abdomen, then belching and hiccups. What is belching? Gas is come out through the mouth, that is the belching, hiccups, then nausea and vomiting, then feeling of the fullness or burning in the stomach, then loss of appetite. Okay, that is known as a anorexia. What is loss of appetite? That is anorexia. Blood into the vomit or stool. Why? Because of the infection or inflammation into the gastric mucosa. So what is gastritis? There is infection or inflammation of the stomach. Now second condition, there is the peptic ulceration. Okay, there will be ulcer into the gastric or stomach. So what is peptic ulceration? So ulceration involves the full thickness of the gastrointestinal mucosa and muscle layer of the stomach and the duodenum. So there is an ulceration that goes deep into the mucosa and into the muscle layer. Okay, mucosa and muscle layer, the ulceration are involved thickness, full thickness. So that is known as a peptic ulcer. Okay. So causative or causative factor, that is corrosive effect of the gastric juice, irritant drug and alcohol. Because of the heavy alcohol consumption and heavy drug ingestion, they cause the ulcer to the gastric mucosa. Now we will see the tumors of the stomach. Okay, in that malignant tumors, okay, malignant, that is a cancerous tumor that is found on the wall of the gastric mucosa or stomach mucosa. You can see in the figure, see, this is the stomach cancer, or we can say tumor, malignant tumor into the stomach. So that is seen in men and women, both sexes, more common in above the 50 years of age, or we can say older people. Then which are the factors that affect the that develop the malignant tumors in stomach? Smoking, alcohol, then high salted diet, then smoked diet and pickled food. So these are the causative agent for the development of the malignant tumor into the stomach. Now, congenital pyloric stenosis. Okay, you can see pyloric stenosis. See, this is the pyloric area and stenosis, okay, means narrow portion. So pyloric stenosis, in that it is uncommon condition in the infant, and spasmodic constriction of the pyloric sphincter. There is a constriction or narrow area in the pyloric sphincter, that is known as a congenital pyloric stenosis. That block the food from entering the small intestine from the stomach, and due to hypertrophy of the muscle of the pylorus. Okay, there is a hypertrophy or enlargement of the pyloric area or pyloric sphincter, and they do not pass the food from the stomach to the small intestine into the duodenum. So this condition is known as a pyloric stenosis. Congenital means during the embryonic development or after the birth in the baby. Now we will see the disease condition which is related to the intestine. In that, first one is a appendicitis. Okay, what is appendicitis? Appendix plus itis means what? Inflammation or infection of appendix. So appendicitis is an inflammation of the appendix. Which are the symptoms? You can see in the figure. See, this is the appendix, and see, this is the inflammation or infection or swollen area in the appendix. That is known as appendicitis. Which are the symptoms? So sudden pain that begins on the right side of the lower abdomen and around the navel, often shift to your lower right abdomen. Okay, why in right side? Because appendix is located at the right side. So in the right abdomen, there will be pain will be start. Pain that worsen if you cough, if you walk or make any movement, any body movement, at that time pain will be start. Nausea and vomiting, then loss of appetite, that is the anorexia. Okay, so an appendectomy is a surgery to remove the appendix when it becomes inflamed. Okay, when it becomes infected or inflamed, appendicitis, in that condition, surgical removal of the appendix. Why? Because there is no any function or no any digestive function in our digestive system. So there will be removal of appendix. It is known as an appendectomy. Ectomy means what? Removal. Appendix or ectomy. Okay, so removal of the appendix, that is known as appendectomy. Okay, so what is appendicitis? Inflammation or infection of the appendix. Now second condition, that is the ascites. Okay, what is ascites? There is a fluid accumulation into the peritoneal cavity. You can see in the figure, there is a fluid accumulation into the peritoneal cavity into the abdomen. There is a peritoneal cavity, so there is a fluid accumulation or collection of the fluid, that is known as a ascites. So more than 25 ml of fluid into the peritoneal cavity, and it may be greater up to the 1 liter fluid may can accumulate. Which are the cause of ascites? So liver cirrhosis or any abnormality of the liver, then cancerous, then heart failure. So these are the disease condition or any abnormality or disease condition related to the organs that is located into the peritoneal cavity. They can cause the ascites. Which are the symptoms for the ascites? So increase the size of the abdomen. You can see there is accumulation of fluid, so that can increase the size of the abdomen. Swelling in the abdomen. Weight gain because of the accumulation of the fluid into the peritoneal cavity. Bloating, nausea and indigestion because of the fluid accumulation into the peritoneal cavity. There will be no proper functioning of the GI tract or organs associated with the digestive system. Then swelling in the lower legs. Okay, in the lower leg there is a swelling. So these are the symptoms of the ascites patient. So for that, surgical or therapy, that is abdominal paracentesis. In that, removal of the fluid that is collected into the peritoneal cavity. So this type of procedure can be done for the removal of the fluid, that is abdominal paracentesis. Now third one is a gastrointestinal infection. Okay, in GI infection occur because of many ways or because of many reasons. In that, first one is a typhoid and paratyphoid fever, or it is known as an enteric fever, that caused by the causative organism for the typhoid and paratyphoid fever, Salmonella typhi, that caused the typhoid fever, and Salmonella paratyphi bacteria, that caused the paratyphoid fever. Then Escherichia coli food poisoning, or we can say E. coli food poisoning, Staphylococcus food poisoning, cholera, in that vomiting and diarrhea is there, and the causative organism for the cholera, that is the Vibrio cholera. Then dysentery, that is caused by the Shigella bacillus, and in that stomach cramps and severe diarrhea with a mucus or blood into the feces. Okay, that is known as a dysentery because of the Shigella bacillus infection. Then viral gastroenteritis means that occur because or causative organism for the gastroenteritis, that is the rotavirus, then norovirus, they cause the diarrhea and vomiting into the patient. So these are the condition that is known as a gastrointestinal infection. Now fourth one is inflammatory bowel disease. Okay, that is represent or told as a known as a IBD. Okay, inflammatory bowel disease. In that, first one is a Crohn's disease. Okay, what is Crohn's disease? Okay, you can see this is a Crohn's disease. Okay, there is inflammation of any part of the digestive tract. Okay, there will be any infection or inflammation of the any part of the digestive tract. Okay, which can lead to abdominal pain, severe diarrhea, 40, weight loss and malnutrition. This type of symptom can be seen into the Crohn's disease. Mostly affected area, which is affected area? Terminal ileum and rectum are major or commonly affected. See, this is the, here there is a terminal ileum. This is the last part of the small intestine and rectum. Okay, in the rectum. They are, these both part are most commonly affected because of the Crohn's disease. So what is Crohn's disease? There is the infection or inflammation of any part of the intestine. Now second condition in the inflammatory bowel disease, that is ulcerative colitis. Okay, what is ulcerative colitis? Inflammation of the mucosa of colon and rectum. There is an inflammation of the mucosa into the colon and the rectum. See, this is the colon, see, this is the rectum. So which may ulcerate and become inflamed, okay, which make ulceration and become inflammation. And main symptom, that is the bloody diarrhea. Why? Because there is a ulcer into the mucosal lining of the rectum and the colon. So that is known as the ulcerative colitis. Major or more ulcer are found into the colon and the rectum. This condition is known as a ulcerative colitis. Now fifth one, that is the hernias. Okay, what is hernias? There is a protrusion of part of an organ. Okay, there is a protrusion of the part of an organ through a weak point or aperture in the surrounding structure. Okay, is there any weak point into the muscle and they form or protrude some part of the organ at the outside that can be visible over the surface of the abdomen? That is known as a hernia, or we can say protrusion of the any part of the organ. So that occur when there are intermittent increase in the intra-abdominal pressure. If you are doing heavy lifting, if you are doing heavy exercise, at that time intra-abdominal pressure will increase and they cause the hernias. Okay, see, this is the type of hernia in the figure. First, this is the epigastric hernia near to the stomach. Then see, this is the umbilical hernia. See, this is at the level or at the area at the navel. Then incisional hernia, so that is occur at the incision side in the abdomen. Then femoral hernia in the femoral area. Then lateral hernia at the lateral side of the abdominal cavity. And inguinal hernia in the groin area. Okay, see, these are the types of the hernia. Okay, epigastric hernia, umbilical hernia in umbilical region, incisional hernia at the incision side, femoral hernia at the side of the femoral region, lateral hernia at the lateral side of the abdomen, inguinal hernia in the groin area. So what is hernia? Protrusion of any part of the organ. The sixth condition, that is the intussusception. So what is intussusception? A length of the intestine is invaginated into itself. You can see this is the intestine that goes inside of the intestine. Okay, so it invaginated into itself, that cause the intestinal obstruction. You can see there is the blockage or obstruction into the intestine. So also part of the intestine that slide into the adjacent part of the intestine. The part of the intestine that slide into the adjacent part, see, this is the adjacent part of the intestine, that is known as the intussusception. Also, it also cut off the blood supply to the part of the intestine that is affected. So in affected area, the blood supply will cut off. Okay, so this condition is known as the intussusception. Now seven, there is a intestinal obstruction. Okay, there is a blockage of the intestine or obstruction into the intestine. So there is a mechanical blockage arising from the structural abnormality that present a physical barrier to the progression of gut content into the next part. Okay, there will be a mechanical blockage or physical barrier that will be developed from the structure of the intestine, that is known as the intestinal obstruction. So there will be partial or complete blockage. Okay, sometime partial obstruction or sometime complete obstruction. Which are the causes for the intestinal obstruction? Like hernia. Okay, then adhesion or bend after the surgery. Okay, there will be bend. Okay, here, like for example, bend of the any part. Then intussusception. Okay, some part is slide over the intestine, that is the intussusception. So these are the causative or causative activity. Next one is a malabsorption. Okay, what is malabsorption? The impaired absorption of the nutrients and water from the intestine. Okay, there will be irritation of the mucosa and they are unable to absorb the nutrients or food or minerals or the water. So this condition is known as the malabsorption. Which are the causes of the malabsorption? So abnormal change into the villi or digestion of the food. If digestion of food is not occur properly, there will be no absorption into the intestinal wall. So there will be changes into the mucosal lining or functional changes or structural changes into the villi. So they can cause the malabsorption. Now we will see the disease condition which is related to the pancreas. Okay, in that pancreatitis. Okay, what is pancreatitis? Means pancreas, and itis means pancreatitis. Okay, means inflammation of the pancreas. So swollen or inflammation or infection of the pancreas, that is known as a pancreatitis. So symptoms in that upper abdominal pain, so that radiate to the back and feel worse after the eating, then nausea and vomiting, then tenderness or swollen after the touching to the abdomen. If you are touched to the abdomen, the swollen and tenderness will be filled. So what is pancreatitis? Infection or inflammation of the pancreas. Now we will see the disease of the liver. Okay, in that first one is a hepatitis. Okay, what is hepatitis? Infection or inflammation of the liver, that is known as a hepatitis. So it is a viral infection. Okay, hepatitis virus can cause the infection and they cause the hepatitis. So it is autoimmune hepatitis, and sometimes, or what is autoimmune hepatitis? The body cell, okay, inside of the body, they can cause the infection, or they can cause the infection or inflammation to the liver. Self body is causing the infection into the liver, that is autoimmune hepatitis. Then hepatitis that occur as a secondary result from the medication, drugs, toxin and the alcohol. These are the causative factors that cause the infection. So what is hepatitis? Inflammation of the liver. Now cirrhosis of liver. Okay, second, that is a cirrhosis of liver. So it is a last stage of scarring or fibrosis of the liver. Okay, what is cirrhosis of the liver? It is a scarring or fibrosis of the liver. So it is caused by the many form of the liver disease and other condition such as the hepatitis and chronic alcoholism. Because of the heavy ingestion of the alcohol and chronic hepatitis can cause the cirrhosis of the liver. So what is liver? You can see this is the picture of the cirrhosis of the liver. Okay, there is scarring or fibrosis of the liver. Now third one is a liver failure. Okay, this occur when liver function is markedly impaired, when liver is unable to perform a particular function, then it is known as a liver failure. So stages of the liver failure, in that first inflammation of the liver, then fibrosis in the liver, means scar tissue that start to replace healthy tissue into the inflammation of the liver. Then third one is a cirrhosis of the liver, means scarring of the severe scarring that may that occur and that make difficult for the liver to function properly. Then end stage liver disease, and lastly there is liver cancer. Okay, see, these are the stages of the liver failure. They fail to do perform some particular function of the liver, that is liver failure. Now fourth one is that is a tumor of the liver. If there is any tumor into the liver, okay, it might be benign or it might be malignant. Okay, so tumors are abnormal masses of the tissue that form when cell begin to reproduce at an increased rate. Okay, when cell or tissue do abnormal growth, okay, and they form a mass, so that is known as a tumor. It might be non-cancerous, that is known as a benign. It might be cancerous, that is known as a malignant tumor. You can see this is the picture of the tumor of the liver. Now we will see the disorder or disease condition of the gallbladder and the bile duct. Okay, in that first one is a gallstone, that is known as a cholelithiasis. Okay, cholelithiasis. It is also known as a gallstones. So what is cholelithiasis? There will be a presence of the gallstone into the gallbladder. See, this is the gallstone that is present into the gallbladder, that is known as a cholelithiasis. Second, there is the cholelithiasis. Means what? There is presence of the one or more gallstone into the common bile duct. Okay, when the gallstone is present into the bile duct, that is known as a cholelithiasis. Then next condition, that is the cholecystitis. Okay, what is cholecystitis? Inflammation of the gallbladder. Okay, infection or inflammation of the gallbladder, cholecystitis. Okay, that is why cholecystitis occur, infection or inflammation, because there is a presence of the gallstone into the gallbladder. They can also cause the cholecystitis. Then cholangitis. What is cholangitis? The infection or inflammation of bile duct. Okay, see, this is the bile duct. Okay, so there is infection or inflammation of the bile duct, that is known as a cholangitis. Okay, that is caused by the bacterial infection, or that can be accompanied by abdominal pain, fever and the jaundice. Okay, these are the causative organism, or these are the causative action. Now jaundice. Okay, what is jaundice? So it is a condition in which skin, white of the eyes, sclera or mucous membrane, that turns into the yellow color. Why? Because of the high level of the bilirubin, a yellow orange bile pigment. Okay, high level of the bilirubin that present into the skin, white of the eye, sclera and the conjunctiva and mucous membrane in the skin, so they turns into the yellow color. So this condition is known as a jaundice. Okay, so jaundice has a many causes like hepatitis, gallstones and the tumors. So these are the condition can cause the jaundice. Which are the symptoms? So abdominal pain, okay, flu like symptoms, change in the skin color, that is in yellow color, dark colored urine because of the presence of the bilirubin, and clay colored stool. So these are the symptoms of the jaundice. So what is jaundice? Yellowish color into the skin, mucous membrane and into the eye. So these are the disorder which is related to the digestive system. Okay. Thank you.